all it took. A stranger's glance, it got me hooked. And I follow you across the stars. I look for you in CD bars.
Good evening. I'm Coulter One Kite. I'm already into the 420, dammit.
So what are you doing?
Nothing.
Why not?
Trying to get on this lifestyle radio website.
Sounds like a cool website.
Yeah, it's alright. Oh, yeah, I might have it.
You might have it.
You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
The opinions expressed during this show are those of the individual participants and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of their associated organizations or Lifestyle Radio.
And politicians, no one's willing to step up and speak.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Pace Radio Show. We are live, and we are coming to you from lifestyleradio.net, also .ca, and from the front window of Canada Days in downtown Campbellford. I'm your host, Al Graham. Tonight, I am joined by my joint host, Alicia Yashecheshen. And she has brought us a guest that has been before the courts many times, helping patients in their fights for their cannabis. But before we find out more, as always, Alicia and I are going to have a bit of a chat. Well, Alicia, what's new and exciting in Saskatchewan?
It's cooled off here, so it's pretty cold. And I'm not pretty appreciating that.
Pretty cold. I can tell you, Saturday night here for a long weekend, I was looking for frost. It was cold. Like what's going on? Where's our warm weather? Where's summer gone?
I know. It seems like that hot, like 30, 40 range is gone now. And that really makes me sad because then it reminds me that fall's coming.
Well,
I love fall, but...
To tell you the truth, I was coming back from camping on the weekend there. And Monday, it was Monday afternoon, and we could see some of the leaves had already started to change. Some of them had already started to go red. I'm getting ugly looks from the employee here. Shannon's going, oh no. To know that, hey, you know, fall is already starting in some places. So, let's see. Have you seen these news reports on people or officials are saying that they're finding fentanyl in cannabis?
I think that's just a scare tactic. Again, it's like the whole reefer madness thing. I don't think that it has any merit to it whatsoever, because the article that you're specifically mentioning says that it was actually urine tests that were sampled and they found the opiates by virtue of that, which I think, it's kind of like BS, right? Because the person in the article suggested that they've never smoked marijuana or taken opiates, but yet they've tested positive. Yeah. So again, I think it just relates back to that kind of reefer madness. And it's not something to just discredit or ignore for sure. One should always be safe when they're purchasing their cannabis. But isn't that the reason why legalization is supposed to be taking place, is so that we can avoid things like fentanyl and marijuana? But as far as I'm concerned, I think that's malicious gossip, and I don't think that there's any truth to it. What about you, Al? Do you think that, you know,
well,
it should be theory?
Maybe
from the government.
Yeah. You know, they've always said that, cannabis has been laced with PCBs, or some people say spray it with Coca-Cola, or it's laced with Coke. One question I've been asking online is, what's the effect of smoked fentanyl? And
very
I get that.
True.
I get that as an answer from everybody. Silence. Yeah, no one's responded to that question. Like, can you even, is there even any effect to smoke fentanyl? I don't know, what happens if you grind up an aspirin and throw it in your joint? Could you get really high, like, as if you swallowed a couple of aspirins?
That's a very good point that you make. Yeah. I've never considered that. And would it be, like, an instant death, like, as it is when you smoke it with, like, chemical drugs, right? Because that's what they say with fentanyl, is that it's almost immediate. You have this overdose. So is that true with cannabis? I don't know.
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. It's you know, they could be putting, even it's frustrating. If you don't, people can just go ahead and say these things and then just throw it out there, and then we're left to fight against it. Yeah, you know, we don't have access to laboratories.
The whole reefer madness thing, right? Like the government or whomever, like Health Canada, for instance, will just, you know, name someone just to name. But they always throw out this misinformation and then they inform the masses about this information, right? Yeah. And so I think that we do ourselves a great injustice by listening to propaganda perpetuated by the government or governmental organizations, right?
Yeah, and you know, now they're advising that cannabis users carry naloxone along with them in case they overdose from the fentanyl.
But okay, let's take a step back and look at the grander picture. Why do we have a fentanyl epidemic in this country, in North America? Why is that?
A huge amount of it's got the effects of overprescription of opiate drugs.
And so we're still in a climate where a doctor will overprescribe something that will literally kill you, but they won't prescribe cannabis. So the hypocrisy within our society in this day and age is just astronomically asinine.
Yep. Oh, it is. It
and
is.
And as far as I'm concerned, if you want to clean up the opiate epidemic, you have to go after doctors and stop doctors because they're the ones fueling this and pharmacists.
Yeah, they're not helping, that's for sure. You know, some of them are pretty easy on signing that stuff. And I know that the government's trying to crack down on things. You know, they're asking for IDs and stuff when you're going to pick up the medication. But, you know, it still ends up on the street.
Oh, for sure. And, like, why has this illicit market of chemical drugs, like, just boomed? Because of prohibition, right? Like, people have no other options. You go to the doctor, and that's what the doctor says. So we trust the, you know, the men and women in white coats to be authentic and have our best interest at heart. And fundamentally, when you take back all of the lies, it's not even true. It's so that they can get that free trip to Aruba, so they prescribe X amount of pills for X amount of patients. I find it ironic that most doctors say, I'm not a pill pusher, but then 10 minutes later, oh, so you want that prescription then?
Yes,
I'm not a pill pusher. If I hear that one more time, like if I had a penny for every time I heard that, like I'd be rich, right? Like doctors are fundamentally the issue within society. And the thing that scares me, and I was there too, is that you trust these people with your life, with your body, and they don't have your best interest at heart. They have their bottom dollar at the end of the day, that's their what they're most interested in is their own careers and getting paid. So
yeah, many do.
Where the compassion fell off along the way, I don't know, right?
Yeah, and I know here in Ontario, you know, they can get suspended, their license suspended, or be to a point where they're not allowed to sign for narcotics because they've doled out too many.
All right. How many, like, colleges of physicians and surgeons actually go after doctors appropriately? I would really love to know.
Well, they went after one for signing for cannabis, and now all of a sudden, you know, here we got an epidemic North America-wide for the opiates. Yeah, they're not going after all those doctors, but they went after one doctor that would sign a lot of cannabis paperwork.
And that's atrocious. Like, that's absurd. Like, me one overdose case of cannabis that's taken someone's life. And I think that that's why they're trying to throw in this whole fentanyl thing with cannabis so that people, like, are like, oh, that's not medicine. But you know, the propaganda that people are fed on a daily basis by the government, like, thank God for technology, because we would be so indoctrinated with the crap that they sell, right? Especially about cannabis.
The internet's unleashed the truth. Or tell it, for sure. All right.
Makes me sad in this province, sorry to cut you off, Al, but is about STC. They recently got rid of Tommy Douglas's bus service. And I've heard so many stories of seniors that are stranded now in, like, little Kenora, Saskatchewan, because the bus is gone. So government is not always in our best interest. And the more we see that, the more we have to change that.
Yeah, I think I saw something about you suing some more government people, so you're out to make change. That's what I'm saying.
Exactly.
All right. Well, we should bring in our guest. What do you say?
For sure.
Okay. At this time, I'd like to welcome the person as a man, I said, who's been in court fighting for patients. And we'd like to say welcome to the Pace Radio Show to John Turmel. Hello, John. How are you?
Hi there. I'm fine.
Good. Good. And how's things been lately?
Well, busy. You know, I mean, even under Trudeau, they're still busting over 50,000 people a year, so it's keeping the defense lawyers and the crowns busy.
Yes, they are, aren't they? They do say that there are fewer arrests, but there's still too many arrests, for sure.
Well, at last count, I saw in the news it was 55,000 last year. And it's been about 50,000 for the last 15, 20 years. My whole memory, it's always around 50,000 a year.
That's that's not right. It's not right,
yeah,
for sure.
Yeah.
And you're the kind of person that I know that has been in courts fighting for those things. And those are some of the things I'm sure that Alicia will be touching on as the night goes on. Right, Alicia?
Yeah.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah. All right. Well, what we do here, John, is I'll let Alicia get going.
Okay.
You're her guest. She'll get the questions started, and I'll jump in as we go along.
Okay, fine.
All right. Okay, Alicia, over to you.
Thanks. So welcome, John. Thanks for coming on the show. We really appreciate that.
Fine.
And so what I like to do with my guests is have them take us back to your first experience with cannabis. How did cannabis become a part of your life?
Oh, Jesus. I think I was 26 years old. I was 26 years old and was going on a trip, and someone offered me some, and I gave it a try, and it was a mild high, and I just kept smoking since then. So that's 40 years.
And so you've been smoking it recreationally then?
Well, yeah. I mean, I don't have any particular medicinal needs. I use it for prevention. Okay? There was a time back at 15 years ago when one of my cases, I was arguing that I wanted it for medical use for prevention. I said, I want it for all the diseases it's good for once you got it before I get it. And the court said, gee, there's no proof that it's good to prevent what it's good for once you got it before you get it. And I went, oh, really? No proof, you say? So these are judges, you know, what I consider the bottom of the barrel when it comes to low tech. And I have not been impressed over my career with judicial decisions. But it's, so it's been, you know, busy since what? Back in 2000, when my brother got busted growing for his wife. And I had just finished doing something at the United Nations, and my brother said, hey, listen, where can you go after the UN trying to fight for interest-free banking? He said, time to come back and fight to legalize marijuana. So I came back to Canada, and within a week, I filed a judicial review against Health Canada in federal court for Jean-Charles Parizeau, who was was Canada's first exemptee. I think there were two guys issued on the same day. So anyway, he had been allowed the right to produce three plants, which were supposed to grow him 1 gram a day. And I said, that seems unreasonable. So anyway, that started the whole thing off. Next thing you know, within a year, I think I had 11 people at the Supreme Court of Canada building, in 2002, all of them demanding their exemptions because Health Canada used to stall people for years. Imagine 2 years to get an exemption. Now it's only 4 or 5 months. But then they tried, there was no rush. They tried to stall as much as possible. So that was helping people fight for their exemptions. But then after the Parker decision came down, if you remember that in 2000, where my brother was busted a week before Parker. But the Parker decision, yeah. But the Parker decision ruled that you could not have a prohibition without having an exemption for sick people. So they gave them a year to set up an exemption. Then they did set up the MMAR, and they came out on the last day of that year. Then 2 years later, the courts found in Hitzig that the exemption hadn't worked. Well, bad exemption, no offense. That's the Parker decision. Therefore, when they found that the exemption had been defective for 2 years, they had to quash the charges against a kid named JP from Windsor. And then they then let go 4,000 more people that year. So, and that was across Canada. So in 2003, they withdrew 4,000 charges all at once because the exemption had not been working, and that means there's no prohibition absent an exemption. So now, fast forward to now. Now, the court said that by fixing the exemption, it brought the law back to life. Well, we argued. We said, hey, once prohibition was dead, it takes Parliament to bring it back to life. But all the judges and all the lawyers said, no, we're going to believe that the courts can bring laws back to life because we want to keep busting everybody. So I spent the next 10 years fighting those kinds of cases, always trying to get a judge to rule that the prohibition is dead. But in 2015 and 2016, the two big decisions happened. The Smith case at the Supreme Court of Canada, which ruled that prohibition on anything but dried violated people's rights. Well, the Hitzig decision in 2003 had ruled that not letting them grow enough patients per gardener and enough gardeners per garden constituted an ineffective exemption, therefore the prohibition was dead. Well, here we have 2015, where the court ruled that it ain't missupply, malsupply, it's malus. You order the people to use it wrong. You can't put dried bud on a nose cancer. It's got to be oil. And by banning oil, well, that was banning the effective use of the product, which made the exemption, I believe, illusory. So we started trying to get the law struck down because the exemption hadn't worked because it had banned oil. But we could never get it in front of a court. They'd always throw it out without hearing it. Then the Allard decision came down last year, and that's a good one. Let me give you an example. We have a whole bunch of Quebec cases going on right now. But tomorrow, I'm leaving this, right after this show is over, and I'm driving to Saint-Jérôme, where Adrien Sturm and his wife, Carolyn Sturm, are going to be. Now, here's their quick story. 2 years ago, they had a house fire in their garage when the firemen discovered a grow with 60-some plants. Okay, so they call the cops. The cops show up, charge them with production for the purpose of trafficking and possession for the purpose of trafficking. Now, like other cases, I advise, if the law's not dead, then they're guilty. So the first thing they do is they make a motion to quash their charges on the grounds of Allard. Allard just said that the MMPR was invalid, and I was busted while the MMPR was the regime. Therefore, like JP had his charge quashed in 03, I'm asking to have my charge quashed now. So, we have, we had a kid in Gatineau, what was his name? The trial took 25 minutes with a jury. We make him get a jury. Same with Adrien, a jury. Now, that's move number one. That's called the quash motion based on Allard. Now, if a judge won't quash the charge on the grounds that Allard killed it, well, we now file a constitutional motion to kill it again. It should be dead. It ain't working. You know, you got to apply every year. You know, I mean, you got to destroy your old pot. Doctors ain't signing. All sorts of reasons why we want to argue that the exemption is flawed and we want it killed. So that is separate, and I call that Myrna. Do you remember the Myrna case?
Yeah, I do.
All right. Well, most people don't really know what happened, but Myrna put a bunch of sick patients on the stand, and they all said our doctors wouldn't sign, and the judge went, wow, 90% of the judges in Canada ain't signing. This exemption ain't working. Now, back in 03, in 01, the Parker decision, that was the one that struck down possession as a violation of our rights. But 6 months later, first of all, they said, we can't strike down cultivation because they didn't appeal it. Well, 6 months later, the Alberta court struck down the cultivation prohibition and the Alberta Court of Appeal in March 2003. So both possession and cultivation are invalid when you don't have an exemption. So Murnau's judge, Taliano, said, hey, with no doctors sign, with only like under 10% signing, this ain't working. I declare that the prohibitions on possession and cultivation are invalid. Yay! Big news across the country. Then they get to the Court of Appeal, and the Court of Appeal said, whoa, you didn't ask them why. They said no. Maybe 90% of the doctors all had good reasons. We don't know. So we dismissed Taliano's decision, send it back for a new trial. And now the government says we're going to stay the charge because we don't want to lose again. Got it? That's what happened. Myrna won, but he was missing the why. And when they sent the trial back, they called it off instead of letting them find out why. So, our constitutional motion, I call Myrna plus Y. We have Will Says from our witnesses explaining the non-medical reasons their doctor said no. Oh, he didn't want to be known as a pot doctor. His insurance company told him not to. His doctor's association told him not to. He hasn't done any homework on it. Whatever excuse ain't medical. Which means that they're saying no for non-medical reasons. So that is our second move, the constitutional charter move. Now, Nicola Fontana in Gatineau, Adrienne Sturman, the wife in Montreal, so far they have, when they've presented their constitutional motion, the judges said, we're dismissing it without reading it. Okay, we don't think this is properly done. Whatever excuse they use, our only point is how come Myrna could make the constitutional argument that the doctors ain't signing, and then we're not allowed to make the constitutional argument, here's why they ain't signing. So we have more people who have filed these motions, these constitutional motions. So that's the kind of case that Adrien had. Now, back to his story now because it's so interesting. It's unique, actually. So, at his trial, first of all, he tried to get the quash motion heard because you're supposed to try and quash and fix the charge before you even bother getting a lawyer and starting a trial. If there's something wrong with the indictment, this is Section 601 to amend the indictment. And that's if the law is dead, too. That's where you do a quash motion. So, he had that filed. But before, when he got to trial, now, first of all, many judges say, oh, this is a constitutional issue because you're relying on Parker and Hitzig or Krieger and Hitzig or Allard. These are constitutional cases. Well, yeah, those were, but not ours. And JP wasn't constitutional. He didn't have to give a notice of constitutional question, so neither do we. So, but anyway, they just put it off and said, to the trial judge. So it gets to the trial now, and the judge goes and deals with the charter motion first. And he just puts the quash motion because of Allard on the back burner. So, deals with the charter motion, says I'm going to dismiss it. I don't believe that John Turmel's expert witness testimony in the mathematics of gambling is related to the right to life. Now, I'm an expert in the mathematics of gambling, and I've been accepted in the federal court tax and seven other courts as an expert. And I was going to simply testify that when 90% of the doctors ain't signing, that reduces the chances of a patient getting his medicine. Make sense?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Yep. Now, when they have to destroy their old pot because they had some left at the end of last month, which means if they run short this month, they got none. That reduces the chances of life again. So, if you get my point, I can look at all 20 of our complaints against the regimes and simply say, hey, the odds of surviving are reduced if you do this dumb thing. Like not let them use oil. That's another dumb one. Not let them swap and trade strains so they can, you know, different strains for different pains. They should be exempt from trafficking amongst themselves. So there's all these issues we raised, and they ignored it. So back to Adrien now. He has now got his jury trial, and he stands up and he admits all the facts, says, yes, we grew it, yes, da-da-da-da, and then the jury finds him guilty. We expect that. And then the judge sentenced him to the mandatory 6 months because he had over six plants. Now, we got a guy in Salaberry de Valley Field. They're going for the mandatory 6 months minimum, and he had eight plants. And because he filed a quash motion and a charter to fight back, they then threw in the charges for possession of some resin. You get it? So, anyway, the point is a guy with eight plants is facing 6 months in jail in Salaberry. But let's get back to Adrien now. Adrien, after the trial was finished, he said, by the way, I still got this quash motion that says Allard struck down the exemption. And JP Court of Appeal Ontario said that when there's, you know, what, they quashed his charge when the exemption wasn't working. Well, I still want my charge quashed. And the judge said, I'm dismissing that summarily, too. Okay. So now they're both dismissed his motions, and he was sent to jail. Now, the neat thing is, there was a mistake in his charter motion. He had forgotten, to change and amend it up from the It's from the MMAR to the MMPR. So the judge was okay in saying, because you cited the wrong regime, I'm going to throw out your case, your Myrna on the doctors. I went, okay. In the meantime, we've asked that the MMPR be declared invalid because of Allard. Okay? So in the quash motion, we properly asked against the MMPR. And the judge dismissed it, saying it was the same as his dismissal of the motion against the MMAR. So, we got him on a bad mistake. So, Adrien is in jail. Now, in Ontario, they have forms, inmate appeal forms, which you fill out, they transmit to the court, 3 days later you have a hearing, and you're out. Pending appeal, if you got any reasonable grounds of appeal. So, in Quebec, they don't have an inmate appeal form. So, I had to send forms to the wife who had to go visit him, get it into the jail. Now, he had to fill out the form. Now, he had to wait 2 days to get a commissioner of oaths. Then, he had to wait till canteen to buy a stamp and an envelope. Then, he mailed it out to his wife, who brought it to the court. Now, the court then wrote back and said, we can't do it because you have to produce a transcript. I had included in the motion, I want the judge to dispense with the transcript. So I called the clerk and I said, hey, what judge said he wasn't going to dispense with the transcript? What's the order? And the clerk went, what do you mean an order? And I said, well, come on, I've asked the judge to dispense. If you're telling me he can't go forward without the transcript, it means the decision is no. He said, well, send me a letter why the judge has to give an order. So I wrote a letter, and I said, since I asked in the motion to dispense with it, it's not the clerk's decision. It's the judge's decision. So I got a, the wife got a call later that afternoon, and they said, okay, he's booked in 3 days. 3 days later, he got out. So it took 20 days to get him out of jail in Quebec, whereas in Ontario, I had Mike South out of jail in 4. You know, I had Sean Maloney out of jail in a week. Well, mind you, he wasn't in jail. It was weekends. So my point is, in Ontario, there's a form to get you out in 4 days, but in Quebec, it took 20 days, almost 3 weeks, 5 times longer. So anyway, he's now out. Now, he filed an appeal against his sentence.
Hey, John.
Yeah?
Hey, John. Can I get you to hold it there, and we go to a commercial break, and you can continue the story when we come back?
Okay, we're coming back with, okay, he's out of jail now, filing his appeal against sentence.
Yeah.
All right, okay.
Yeah. All right, bumper music tonight is by Ill Scarlet and their song Justice, being we're talking justice with John here. And then we get back. Alicia and I will continue our conversation with John Turmel. This is Pace Radio Show live on lifestyleradio.net. Pace Radio Show live on lifestyleradio.net.
Power to the people. Every soul is equal. Overcome the systems and arise above the evil.
Canada, the time to act is now. These days, your customers are seeking variety. Increase your earning potential by expanding your inventory with CC Nexus, Canada's largest cannabis seed wholesaler. CC Nexus stocks over 60 reputable breeders, including Canuck Seeds, with a wealth of auto flower, regular, feminized, and CBD strains. All first-time customers will receive a free pack of Canuck Seeds, plus a mug, t-shirt, and additional promotional materials. Add strains and increase your profit with CC Nexus, your Canadian-owned and operated wholesaler of cannabis seeds. Discreet, worldwide stealth shipping from Canada, supporting you locally. Call today, 1-844-843-7995. 1-844-843-7995. Or visit us at ccnexus.global.
The following is a public service announcement from the Canadian Therapeutic Cannabis Partners Society. The Canadian Therapeutic Cannabis Partners Society is a non-profit organization dedicated to ensuring improved access to therapeutic cannabis and cannabis byproducts in Canada. With a federal government that has committed to legalizing cannabis, we feel it is our duty to ensure that the medicinal use of cannabis doesn't get lost in the process and that there are clear distinctions made between the medicinal and recreational use of cannabis. It is our mission to ensure that government regulation doesn't get in the way of a sick, disabled, or terminally ill person's right to use or produce this amazing natural health product. If you would like to get involved, you can contact us on the internet. www.canadiantherapeuticcannabispartners.com. On Facebook, CTCP Society. Or search Canadian Therapeutic Cannabis Partners.
CTCP now operates a medicinal cannabis signing clinic. If you want to grow your own medicinal cannabis and are located anywhere in Canada, then I'd like to suggest that you give them a call. They can be reached at 1-613-967-9888. That's 1-613-967-9888. And grow on with CTCP.
Man, have you been to Canna Days yet?
Canna Days.
Campbellford's premier cannabis culture shop at 19 Bridge Street West. They've got bongs, oil rigs, grinders, and papers. Everything you need for consumption. They've got seeds, soil, nutrients, and dome trays too. Everything you need for cultivation. Get top quality seeds from top suppliers like Canuck, Crop King, and wholesaler Nexus.
Canna Days.
They've got all kinds of awesome cannabis novelties, clothing, and apparel. I know, right? It's a lot more than just a bong shop. Interested in gaining legal access? Canna Days can help. They're a PACE information center. You know, people advocating cannabis education? Come by the shop and check it out. 19 Bridge Street West, Campbellford.
Canna Days.
Have your say without saying a word. CannaDays.ca.
Growing your own vegetables, flowers, or even medicinal plants can be a challenge without the right equipment and proper know-how. At BMA Hydroponics, not only are they your urban horticultural experts and suppliers, but their staff holds the customer's needs paramount to making a sale. Family-owned with decades of experience and knowledge, they offer free advice in person, by phone, or email. BMA Hydroponics wants to ensure you have the advice you need, which is why you'll find tips and tricks on different ways to grow, like wick, ebb and flow, drip, or aeroponic system, as well as other helpful links at bmahydroponics.com. If you can't find what you're looking for, just let them know, and they'll do everything they can to get what you're looking for. At BMA Hydroponics, each staff member also possesses a federal exemptee MMAR license, making their strong suit empathy, experience, and dedication to their customers. Because when you know how to grow, you'll have results that make you proud. BMA Hydroponics in Belleville, Ontario. Visit bmahydroponics.com.
BMA offers cannabinoid testing, so if you want to prove you've got good medicine, head to BMA Hydroponics and prove it.
Get it. You're listening to Lifestyle Radio.
Not yet.
Okay, I believe we're back.
Okay.
We are back. That's good. I am here. I don't know what happened there. But hey, it happens and you continue on, right? Right, Alicia?
For sure.
That's right. The show must go on. That's right. Okay. All right. We are here with John Turmel and joint host Alicia Yashecheshen, and I found my way back. Okay. John, before the commercial break there, you were telling us a story there about some court challenges and stuff. Do you remember where you left off?
Yeah. So Adrian Stern and his wife went to trial, and the jury came back, and he was convicted of production for the purpose of trafficking, but they found her not guilty because all the evidence showed he grew it, he sold it, she didn't do anything. But you know how they throw in the bus to the family and the kids usually? Well, they threw her in too, and the jury found her not guilty. They found him guilty. Now, he had his first motion, the charter motion, dismissed summarily. Then at the end, before it's over, he blurts out to the judge, "Whoa, what about my charter motion?" And the judge said, "I'm dismissing that one summarily too." Boom, gone. All right, now. And so now he has filed a notice of appeal, and his application for release pending appeal was granted. What's interesting, Justice Schrager, in granting his release, said, "I'm granting it because I don't think the appeal is frivolous." Now, remember, the charter motion was dismissed by Justice Boucher properly because we'd put in the MMAR instead of the MMPR. So we're only appealing on the grounds of the quash motion, which did say MMPR, and because of Allard, not Murnau. So,
and they wouldn't allow you to amend it?
Pardon?
Like they threw the motion out because you used the wrong legislation, but they wouldn't allow you the opportunity to amend it?
Well, you see, I wasn't talking for him, and the judge just handed down his decision. He didn't give him a chance to amend it. But it's not important because Max Gauthier in Montreal, he's raising the constitutional. So is the guy in Quebec City, and so did the guy in Gatineau. We got lots of constitutionals in appeal. It's not important. Adrian have it. But Adrian has appealed on the single ground that the exemption was invalid, said Allard, when he was busted. So, according to Parker, bad exemption, no offense, he should be quashed, his charge. So, he appeals his conviction only on the basis of the quash motion being dismissed, on the basis of Allard, not the Murnau. Now at the Court of Appeal, he now has to file a motion for release, to appeal the minimum sentence. Here's my point. If they throw out his appeal because of the quash, they're going to have to send him back to jail to finish out his sentence. But if we can win the appeal against mandatory minimums, well, they can let him go with time served. So he filed a motion to appeal his sentence. 2 days later, the Elliott decision out of British Columbia, Court of Appeal, highest court, says we strike down mandatory minimums in BC. What a precedent. So Adrian now has this wonderful precedent. So we've got a hearing coming up for our application for leave to appeal the sentence where he hands in Elliot. Now, in the meantime, the Crown made a motion for the same day to have his appeal against the quash struck as being frivolous and vexatious. Well, the judge said, whoa, Justice Schrager already said this isn't frivolous. What are you going to do? Mm-hmm. He said, well, we're going to make the motion that it's frivolous anyway. She went, all right, if you do that, then I'm putting the decision on whether to give you leave to appeal the sentence off and to a panel who's going to hear the other Crown's motion to reject the appeal against conviction because of the quash, summarily for being frivolous. So now we finally have our hearing again. Now, they have to do this. You have to go see the registrar clerk of the court, a hearing before the clerk, and you have to convince the clerk that this is frivolous before she'll send it to a panel of three judges to throw it out. Well, I mean, all Adrien did was show that, first of all, he tried to explain that the MMPR, we were challenging it, but he didn't really get it out because he's not a lawyer and it's in the information. So the Lady Justice, she has now referred his appeal against conviction to a three-judge panel to be dismissed as frivolous. Okay? Now, here's the point. The Crown Attorney told her about the charter motion that had been dismissed because of MMAR. And the Crown Attorney, being a different Crown Attorney from the trial Crown Attorney, didn't even know about the second motion, the quash motion. He only knows about the charter motion. So the clerk only knew about the charter motion. She didn't know about the quash motion. Yet in our notice of appeal, it says we are appealing the dismissal of the motion under Section 601 to quash. So the judge, the lady judge, the lady clerk got it wrong and doesn't even know that we're not appealing on what she thinks we're appealing. We're appealing on another motion in the file that they don't even know about. Okay? We know it's in there. We know the judge dismissed it in 1 minute. But we have the decision on the conviction, the judge's transcript, but we don't have the transcript of the 30 seconds when he said, I dismiss it summarily. So Adrian's going back to get that transcript printed out. And at the next hearing coming up in September, we're just going to show them, look, here's two motions and here's two decisions, and they only know about one, the wrong one. Isn't that funny? And in the meantime, now his other motion for his appeal against his sentence, well, I would expect that they're going to let it in simply because what if it wins at the Supreme Court of Canada? That means that these judges are going to put a guy back in jail under mandatory minimum when he tried to appeal and pointed out that the Elliott decision is there, and they're going to send him back to jail, and then the Supreme Court lets Elliott win, proving they were wrong? I don't think they're going to do that. I think the Elliott case dropped in his lap beautifully. Now, that's Adrian, okay, with his appeal against conviction and his applications to appeal against the mandatory minimum. But his wife, now, they're, here's what's neat. Possession for the purpose of trafficking gets tried in regular court. But production for the purpose of trafficking has to be a jury trial, if you want. So Adrian picked a jury trial for the production, but now they still have to go do a regular trial for the possession. Got it? Now, here's the point. Adrian was convicted. She was acquitted. Now, there's something called double jeopardy. In Canada, it's called autrefois acquis, already acquitted or already convicted, autrefois convict. So, double jeopardy basically, if she filed a double jeopardy motion, she argued that not only is possession for the purpose of trafficking similar to production for the purpose of trafficking, but it's derivative. I couldn't possess for the purpose of trafficking if I wasn't the one producing for the purpose of trafficking, unless you got some evidence that sees me handling the pot, right? So, we filed a motion for double jeopardy, which is going to be heard tomorrow. Now, double jeopardy is a well-known legal argument, but no one ever gets to make it. How often do you see a Crown Attorney use the same facts to go after someone twice? But when they do pot charges, they do lay out many derivative charges, which, if you're convicted under one, should preclude any conviction under the other. So, Now, it applies to both him convicted and her acquitted. But because he's going on to appeal, and maybe he wins, who knows, we're going in to get her possession for the purpose of trafficking charge quashed or thrown out tomorrow on double jeopardy. Then, if she wins, then we can tell the Crown, hey, he's going to win too next time. So, if he wins his appeal, the law is dead and the possession charge dies. And if he loses his appeal, he's convicted of production, well, you can't get him for possession anyway. So we want you to drop it. So that's the Sturm case going on tomorrow. The wife is going in to try and set a double jeopardy precedent, saying, now that I've been acquitted of not producing it, and you got no evidence showing me possessing it, well, what's your purpose in going forward with a charge of possession when I've already been found not guilty of production? Great case, eh? So, that happening tomorrow, I can't wait to see what happens. And then, of course, if she wins, then he's going to have to get his charges dropped, the lower court ones, too. And then he'll be at the Court of Appeal with his appeal against conviction because Allard said the exemption was defective when he was busted, meaning the law is dead. Krieger said cultivation invalid, absent exemption. Parker said possession invalid, absent exemption. So as soon as the, again, he's going to his appeal if the courts don't find it frivolous. And two judges have already cited that they don't think it's frivolous. And yet this stupid clerk goes and sends the case off to panels of judges knowing they already said it wasn't frivolous. And she just can't understand how it's not frivolous because she ain't looking at the right case.
And so in terms of all of these actions, is it costly to go to court? Like, these people are self-representing themselves.
Well, yeah, I do the paperwork, and all they have to do is say it's all written down. I got nothing more to say, and see what happens.
Yeah.
So I do the paperwork because I enjoy tormenting the government, and technically I've been attacked three times by the law societies, twice in Ontario and once in Quebec or the other way around. But as long as I don't charge for my advice, hey, I'm not doing anything wrong. If some idiot wants to take the advice of an online legal guru who might be a flake, that's nobody's fault. They can't stop it. So I can't be stopped from publishing my kits that people print, put in their name, file, and use. And so, again, I don't worry about that. And what can I say? The results speak for themselves. My favorite case was James Turner in Ottawa last January, 2016. And he had been busted in 2006. And anyway, after 9 years of chasing him, I mean, I wrote him a motion for prohibition, took it to the Supreme Court, came back. They waited for Murnau to be finished. Finally, the Smith decision came down about oil, and we filed a brand-new quash motion because the oil hadn't worked, and that means that the exemption couldn't have been working in 06 when he was busted because he couldn't have oil, and the government withdrew the charges 1 month before his trial for 2,800 plants.
Oh.
2,800. Well, like, it was the Smith decision that scared them. Like, pardon?
Oh. Well, in terms of disparities and how they apply the law, like, it seems as though, like, with all of the cases that you've been discussing, it seems like everything is a little bit different in each case, per se.
Well, it shouldn't be. Okay. It shouldn't be, but the judges treat it differently, and they give us different reasons to say no, and we have to then appeal those specific reasons. But right now there's lots of action, mainly going on in Quebec, though there's action going on in seven other provinces of people who are fighting their cases. Alberta, BC, Saskatchewan, Ontario, Quebec, Newfoundland, Nova Scotia, I think that's seven. And so people are using the kits all over the place. I don't even hear about them. So it causes troubles, so much paperwork problems that many crown attorneys just say it ain't worth the trouble. We're letting you go. Really? So we can't claim we won, and it doesn't make a precedent that we can use when the crown attorney withdrew the charges against James Turner's 2,800 plants, because you know, they could say, oh, we didn't think it was worth it. There wasn't enough chance. We broke our heart. Whatever. They got any reason they want, but it's not because we were right. So over the last 10, 15 years, I got in my 50 or 60 people who have had either their charges withdrawn or stayed with an absolute discharge, because nobody gets criminal records unless they fight it all the way. So, that's where we are with the Adrian Sturm case now. We are coming up what I believe is big, and it could strike down mandatory minimums in Quebec, as well as find out whether the Allard decision created a period of invalidity in the possession and cultivation prohibitions, like the Hitzig decision did 10 years earlier. So it is 100% exactly the same thing. Bad exemption in 03 meant there was no law and they dropped 4,000 charges. And now we have two declarations, Smith and Allard, that say bad exemption in 2015-16. And we just want them to say the same thing. No John, law, absent exemption.
John, well, in the Parker decision, the judge ruled that the government had 12 months in order to come up with a workable medical cannabis program.
Yes.
Here we are, 11 times it's been in front of the courts for constitutional challenges. We won every time. How can they say cannabis isn't legal when they've never had a workable, valid program? And that was 15 years ago, and they only gave them 12 months.
Yeah, but every time you won, they fixed it. And now it's working! Let me give you an example. In 2000, we're saying that in 2001, when the exemption came out, it was bad. And it took 2 years for the Hitzig decision to find it was flawed. Now, they did not ask, like Myrna did. If you find the exemption is flawed, pursuant to Parker, we want you to declare the prohibitions invalid. No, Hitzig just said, we want to strike down the flaws to make the exemption working. Now, I don't want the flaws struck down. I want the exemption busted, because when it's busted, there's no prohibition. So, on the day we found out, the JP decision, that the exemption had been busted for 2 years and there was no law, is the very same day they announced that Alan Young fixed the exemption and now the law is back alive. Got it?
Oh.
Oh, yes.
The lawyer
fixed the busted exemption. And it was a busted exemption that made the law dead. You got how it works? When the exemption is busted, the law is dead. So when you get lawyers like Alan Young and John Conroy, who want to fix the exemption, they're trying to bring the law back to life. I want the exemption to be not only defective, but declared defective. I don't want to fix it, but on the day that I won our case, but to prove that their law was dead and the 4,000 charges, is the day that Alan Young's Hitzig case struck down the defects, and now the exemption works again, and the law's alive again. Now, that's what Canadians were told. Now, I know that judges can't bring laws back to life. Only Parliament can do it. But they said they did, and all the lawyers pretended they did. So, we've had 10 years worth of busted people, 500,000 people, on a law that was declared invalid, that was brought back to life by judges who can't do that. But we have to pretend it's still alive again and try and kill it again, which we've done. So now we're back with new decisions claiming the exemption didn't work. But we're going for what the same relief Taliano gave Myrna. When Taliano said the exemption didn't work, I'm striking down these two prohibitions. Well, we want the court to admit Allard just said the exemption didn't work, and we want the court to say that the prohibitions are invalid while the MMAR, MMPR wasn't working. So that's coming up in the next, in the next year, I guess, in Quebec. So other provinces are way behind on that end.
Some interesting times coming, for sure.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so, time for a commercial, John.
Okay, good. Perfect timing.
All right, yeah, we'll continue back when we come back from the break. All right. We're going to hear some more of Ill Scarlet and the song Justice. And
all right.
We'll be talking to you again after the break, John. You're listening to the Pace Radio Show. We are live here at lifestyleradio.net.
Every soul is equal. Overcome the system and arise above the evil. The poor keep getting stronger and the rich can't feed the hunger.
Growing your own vegetables, flowers, or even medicinal plants can be a challenge without the right equipment and proper know-how. At BMA Hydroponics, not only are they your urban horticultural experts and suppliers, but their staff holds the customer's needs paramount to making a sale. Family-owned with decades of experience and knowledge, they offer free advice in person by phone or email. BMA Hydroponics wants to ensure you have the advice you need, which is why you'll find tips and tricks on different ways to grow, like wick, ebb and flow, drip, or aeroponic system, as well as other helpful links at bmahydroponics.com. If you can't find what you're looking for, just let them know, and they'll do everything they can to get what you're looking for. At BMA Hydroponics, each staff member also possesses a federal exemptee MMAR license, making their strong suit empathy, experience, and dedication to their customers. Because when you know how to grow, you'll have results that make you proud. BMA Hydroponics in Belleville, Ontario. Visit bmahydroponics.com.
BMA offers cannabinoid testing, so if you want to prove you've got good medicine, head to BMA Hydroponics and prove it.
Man, have you been to Canna Days yet?
Canna Days.
Campbellford's premier cannabis culture shop at 19 Bridge Street West. They've got bongs, oil rigs, grinders, and papers. Everything you need for consumption. They've got seeds, soil, nutrients, and dome trays too. Everything you need for cultivation. Get top quality seeds from top suppliers like Canuck, Crop King, and wholesaler Nexus. Canna Days. They've got all kinds of awesome cannabis novelties, clothing, and apparel. I know, right? It's a lot more than just a bong shop. Interested in gaining legal access? Canna Days can help. They're a PACE information center. You know, people advocating cannabis education? Come by the shop and check it out. 19 Bridge Street West, Campbellford.
Canna Days.
Have your say without saying a word. CannaDays.ca.
Hi, this is Al Graham of the PACE Radio Show. Are you keeping PACE, as in keeping people advocating cannabis education? If you're not, and you're a cannabis consumer, then why not? Others are working hard every day to help educate people about cannabis so you can enjoy your daily 420. Get involved and speak out. Be loud and proud so that you can keep PACE. Tune into the PACE Radio Show every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time to hear about people advocating cannabis education here on lifestyleradio.ca.
Canada, the time to act is now. These days, your customers are seeking variety. Increase your earning potential by expanding your inventory with CC Nexus, Canada's largest cannabis seed wholesaler. CC Nexus stocks over 60 reputable breeders, including Canuck Seeds, with a wealth of auto flower, regular, feminized, and CBD strains. All first-time customers will receive a free pack of Canuck Seeds, plus a mug, t-shirt, and additional promotional materials. Add strains and increase your profit with CC Nexus, your Canadian-owned and operated wholesaler of cannabis seeds. Discreet, worldwide stealth shipping from Canada, supporting you locally. Call today, 1-844-843-7995, 1-844-843-7995, or visit us at ccnexus.global.
Hello?
Yeah?
Okay, good stuff.
I'm here.
Yeah, all right. I'm having mic issues. I'm really going to have to retire this mic. I think we should start a GoFundMe page for Al's new mic.
Let's do it.
All right.
I'm starting the government for donations.
Yeah, that's an idea. See if they'll buy me a new mic. All right. Don't forget, you guys miss our live shows. You can always catch our podcast at Mixcloud, YouTube, iTunes, and iHeartRadio down in the U.S. And let's see. Tonight we have John Turmel on the show, and Alicia, you're here with me as well. Well, where would we like to go in the last segment, John and Alicia?
Well, I don't know. I mean, we could talk about the politics, but, sure. You know, I mean, the dirtiest move would be if Parliament was prorogued before next year. And then we're back with the same situation for another couple of years, with the corporate boys getting an advantage. The whole play was to give the corporate guys an advantage in the game and to try and keep the little guys shut down. I mean, something like over 1,000 applications were sent in, and only 40 so far have been approved for LPs. Okay? That's sickening. And they're charging like $100 a gram for prescriptions, okay? And once you sign, then you go set up your grow op. That might take a month or two to get your DG getting ready and his criminal record check. Then you submit it. Then it takes another 4 or 5 months to get your license. Hey, 7 months is gone. Yeah. You're going to be reapplying with the new doctor fees in 5 months.
I don't know how they could say that's reasonable access where patients are waiting 22 months.
I know. Somebody's
they're not going to end themselves. Find themselves back
well,
for the courts?
It's one of the 20 points in our constitutional motion. Our constitutional motion, you remember the Allard one, talked about indoor, outdoor, no oil, and another one, little ones. But we're talking about the big ones. No doctors like Murnau having to destroy our pot, guys with permanent diseases shouldn't have to renew year after year. It just wastes the doctor's time on purpose, to make sure they cannot process too many people if they have to keep processing last year's guys all over again. So, I mean, so many, 20 different, and not only that, the MMPR had its own series of torts, and then they kept them in the ACA. For instance, did you know that an LP can cancel your prescription for a business reason?
For business reason.
For
really?
A business reason. And they can, and then when they do, the next section says, you can't have your medical document back. You got to go to the doctor and start again. I mean, who dreams up this stuff? What kind of sick people work there? You know, but that's it. They can say, oops, we are short in supply, and he can pay me more, so we're dropping you for a business reason, and you can't have your document back to go find another LP. You got to start again.
Yeah.
I mean, this is so disgustingly dirty, and we have never been able to get the constitutional motion heard yet. All the judges say, all irrelevant, all, you know, and they just dismiss it summarily without ever reading it. That's how dirty it is. And all we can do is focus on the fact, why did Murnau get a chance to bitch about not enough doctors, and we can't bitch about not enough doctors, plus why they said no. We came up with the objection that overturned Murnau. Why? And you won't let us present our evidence? No. So far, the charter motion, you can get these motions at johnturmel.com/kits, K-I-T-S. That's the page that leads to the quash kits, to the constitutional kits. If you're in jail, we'll pop you out of jail for a marijuana conviction. You know, if you want to overturn an old conviction, there's forms for that too. So over the years, every time I came up with a form to do something, for instance, one I've got up there and I'm going to amend is people who were shut down by the NMPR. Half of Canada's growers were shut down by Judge Manson when he said, I extend everybody's grow permits. Hey, but I'm only going to extend possession permits from today on. So the people who let their exemptions expire, waiting to see what I do, you're all screwed. You're all cut off. Half of Canada's exemptee growers were shut down by Manson. Half. So
John, do you think it's a fair assessment to say that dealing in the courts is like gambling?
Well, yeah. I got to say, yeah, because, you know what I mean? You would expect that if it's logical, the judges will go with the logic. But they'll make up any stupid excuse to say no, and they have. And then we have to go appeal and make fun of them in front of the Court of Appeal. And then the Court of Appeal say, we see nothing so wrong, dismissed. Then we go to the Supreme Court, who say, we see nothing of national interest, dismissed. So, yeah, it really is justice in Wonderland, you know?
And so you don't think that, the courts are fair per se when it comes to people who are trying to challenge the discrimination that comes with cannabis? Like you said, that judges will make up just asinine reasons to not allow an order. So do you think that, like, where does that manifest? Is that discrimination? Is that, like, what is that? Is it ignorance? Like...
I presume that the powers that be say, hey, you're not going to legalize pot or we're going to kill all your kids, okay? I just figure there's some kind of coercion by big money for judges to ruin their careers this way in public, saying stupid stuff, you know? So you ask me why the judges would do stuff like this? I don't know. I can only tell you that there's a hidden agenda that keeps going forward. Yet sometimes there are little breaks. Sometimes a judge, if he's not too powerful, will agree and we win. You know, and that's when we start piling on. Now, again, what are they going to do about Elliot out of B.C.? Here they struck down the mandatory minimum, and the Crown Attorney is trying to strike his motion for leave to append his sentence. Well, first of all, they say we got to do it in all the provinces. This is only B.C. You know, and that's one other thing about law that bugs me, is that the government, they say, can put up a law in all the provinces, and when one court of appeal strikes it down, and that's the highest court in that province, technically, if it goes to the Supreme Court, then it's the whole country. But if the government doesn't appeal, they say, now you got to go and prove you're right in every one of the other provinces, too. Huh? You mean because the top court in one province struck it down, it's not binding? Judges say, no, it should be. Okay? So, but...
Yeah, I agree.
What can I say? I'm going back if they insist, and... But we just use the precedent out of B.C. We're going to hand it in, say we adopt all the arguments there. What's your answer? So he's got a really good case there. That was a beautiful thing. And as for them trying to strike his appeal against conviction, hey, they're talking about the wrong motion that we're not appealing. What a joke. I'm still amazed. It's so funny. My last report, I called it Keystone Courts Clerk's Decision. 89 years ago, there were Keystone Cops. They were a cartoon, not cartoon, but comic characters of bumbling cops, you know, riding around in the car almost falling off. The Keystone Cops, who were bumblers. And so these are the Keystone Courts, my favorite line, because they're bumblers too. You know, you figure you'd get better out of guys who can make it to the top of their profession. And you don't. So we are facing a whole bunch of people who keep getting busted. But when they do, if they find out about us, then they put up a fight. And that starts to cost because all our people are going jury trials. Now, that's only they have to call 300 people in to pick a jury pool. That takes a whole day gone. And it costs, they got to give everybody $45 and the jurors 100. So it costs like 10 G's just to get them in the door.
Jeez.
And they have a jury trial, then they don't plead guilty. They're found guilty, so they can appeal. And at the appeal level is where we raise our strong cards, the quash, that the law was dead, or Myrna, plus why the doctor said no, that the law should be dead. And that's where we are on all our cases.
have you seen any cases be thrown out because of the new Jordan decision at the Supreme Court in terms of time?
Well, we've got some of our Max Gauthier in Montreal. He was busted like 34 months ago, almost 3 years ago, and filed a quash motion. Now, they immediately started stalling. They didn't know what to do with it. They put it off, finally put it off to his preliminary inquiry, and then they put it off to his trial, and it's still not at his trial now, 34 months later, so now he's gone to find a lawyer to see if Jordan applies. So, I don't like winning on technicalities. Each case, for me, is a shot at getting the law struck down with a guy who's got the power to do it. So I'm not looking for a technical win ever. I'm always looking for the merits-based win that wins for all of us, not just the guy who got busted.
That changes things, for sure.
Yeah.
Rewriting the laws, like, that's most important.
Yeah.
And so with legalization allegedly on the horizon, like, what do you foresee in terms of that? Like, do you think people will still have to deal with their charges and everything like this up until, like, when? Like, what?
Well, it keeps lawyers working.
It keeps the lawyers working.
Yeah. So exactly. I think that nothing's going to change. I think that they're going to find another excuse to delay. They're going to come up with regulations that still make it illegal for people to grow enough themselves. You know, this bit about four plants each, well, that's not enough for most people, period. But anyway, unless they're big ones outside, I suppose, but who's going to do that, you know, without security?
Yeah.
So,
that's
I mean, I've been looking at the gremlins at Health Canada who've been coming up with these evil, malevolent laws, you know, and I keep striking my forehead and saying, God, what kind of people can dream this stuff up? You know, not only can we cancel your medicine for a business reason, you can't have your prescription back. Oh, what sickness. Anyway, I've got so many. By the way, you can find me just if you Google for John Turmel's blog, I suppose that'll bring you to all of my posts where I do reports, every case, every action, every document, I do a report on it so that my readers are up to date on all the action that's going on. And like I say, when you've got, Quebec City, he was always up to the Court of Appeal once already. He's back down, going back up again to Superior. Anyway, judges keep making all sorts of mistakes, and we keep catching them. And if it wasn't so sad, it would be funny. But we have, as long as Trudeau keeps stalling, it lets me keep trying to score the win.
And you noticed a difference in the way in which they're adjudicating cases from Harper's government to Trudeau's government? Or are they pretty much the same?
No, I've seen nothing different in the courts. I've heard of some judges who've spoken up about not liking the system, not liking prohibition. You know, the guy, Judge Chevalier, who fined a guy a buck and a quarter at one point, you know? So I've heard of those, but no. In general, the name of the game is for the lawyer to bleed the victim until they do a plea deal. So the Crown scares the victim by threatening him with the maximum sentences, and the lawyer keeps going, I'll talk to him, need 200. I'll talk to him, don't need 200. Okay, don't worry, I'll talk to him, need 200. Understand? And that's why they bleed the guy for as long as they can before they do a plea deal and take it off the books. It's disgusting. But lawyers need to work, and Justin's providing them with that. I have a Facebook page called Justin's Busteds for those people who were busted after Justin Trudeau promised he was going to end it. So, you know, people are going to have a real reason to hate the guy, you know? I mean, he promised he was going to fix it, and I got busted, and I lost my house, I lost my job, I lost my family. You know, I mean, they got reason to hate his guts. You know, and I think he's one vaccine shy of full-blown autistic.
And so in terms of, like, the police, what do you see there? It's like, they're obviously, like, the cause of most of the problem, but is there any kind of seeing the light there, or is it just strictly enforcement?
Well, it's the same 55,000 busts as it was 10 years ago. So what's changed? You know, do they have smileier faces? I don't know. But there's still 55,000 busts, you know, almost 5,000 a month. So what can the police be doing differently when they're busting the same amounts?
Yeah. And, like, in terms of, like, enforcement dollars, like, what does that cost? Like, I can't even begin to fathom what we would spend on prohibition of cannabis.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it is a lot of money that could go elsewhere, that's for sure. But if you read 1984, George Orwell, you realize that the whole purpose is for them to waste resources so that we don't get too comfortable. That's reasons for wars. Destroy it before people get to find out things are going well and don't want to fight no more. So I don't know how many billion, probably not too many, one or two, I think, they're spending on busting 55,000 people. Because let's face it, the cops are already being paid. So how many pot busts they throw in there doesn't increase costs.
Yeah, going now to court, now business, that,
maybe.
Now they're asking for more money.
Yeah.
To enforce the new laws.
Well, anyway, I am not too worried about... Look, there are so many big fights that are doable, especially with my kids now. I just tell people, just go do what you got to do and don't even worry. If you can, put the quash motion up in your grow room, you know. So you guys want to bother with me, this is what you're going to get, this kind of a fight. So because, you know, I don't expect it to get better out of the politicians because they manage to find some way to stall it and retard it and prorogue Parliament the last time. Remember when they were going to decriminalize and suddenly Parliament's prorogued and now there's nothing. They can do that again. So
that's right, he can.
Well, he's already kept it alive an extra 3 years and all he's got to do is prorogue it and run an election a year early and then we're all screwed again. So his brother reneged, his father reneged 40 years ago, and now the junior's reneging now, a renegger family.
Well, let's keep our fingers crossed. Go ahead.
Maybe with another party like NDP, perhaps, that has never run a government, maybe giving them a chance to kind of see how they would do things? Do you think that they would turn the situation around? Like, I heard that they're purporting that part of their platform was is that they were going to quash... or get rid of mandatory minimums, which I think, like, how did that ever become law? But we can thank Harper for that.
Coming down. Yeah, mandatory minimums are coming down. So would the NDP do differently? Well, they've promised, but so did the Liberals. And you've seen how they hedge and they sidle and they hesitate and they don't do it. So why would the NDP be any less good at stalling than the Liberals or the Tories? So I don't have much hope in parliamentarians when there's people with big money behind them holding their loans who have hidden agendas.
And so do you think there'll ever come a point in time where cannabis will be free? Like,
Yeah. Absolutely. Soon, even. I would guess within the next 4 or 5 years worldwide. But, I mean, it's too great a resource not to, and it was banned for false reasons. Okay? I mean, it was banned. There have been so many lies about it that have come down that the mere total of lies has to be an indicator that this was a hit job. This was a scam. But the people who, you know, promoted the scam and bad-mouthed marijuana over the last 10, 15, 20, 30 years, they're not going to be punished. Sure, if we went and dug up their name and said, hey, you were one of the guys saying that marijuana caused schizophrenia without noticing that as marijuana use went up, schizophrenia rates did not go up. Didn't you note the correlation wasn't there, sir? So you get these kind of people who repeat these old lies that have been disproven. Like my favorite is the one about, you know, where it slows cognitive abilities. Hey, University of Saskatchewan found in 2005 that marijuana promotes neurogenesis, grows new brain cells, which is why I'm so sharp and my opponents are so dull. My favorite
Very
line
true.
When I run in elections.
Agree.
So I run in elections. If I got elected, for sure, you know, that prohibition would be on the front burner. But I don't know if the other controlled by finance parties are there yet. It would be nice
John,
if one were, but...
You know, we can agree that you you sure have tried to be elected, that's for sure.
Well, yeah, 92 times.
92 times. World record, eh? Guinness Book of World Records, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, hey, I wonder if we'll track trying on. To do your civic duty, get out there and help the people.
Yeah. Well, listen, I haven't been running for 38 years on marijuana. Sure, that's one of my original programs, but the original program is I want an interest-free credit card at the Bank of Canada. I just want you to contemplate how your life would change if you had access to the Bank of Canada instead of having to go through the Royal Loan Sharks. Okay? That's why I've been in politics.
That was their original mandate.
What?
That was the Bank of Canada. That was the Bank of Canada's original mandate, is to provide interest-free loans and like credit products. Was it not?
Exactly, but only to governments. Now I have a graph that shows the national debt for Canada start to grow in 74, and the debt for Ontario start to grow in 74, and the debt for Quebec start to grow in 74, and the debt for France start to grow in. And I'm going, what happened? In 1974, the Bank of Canada stopped making interest-free loans to provinces and government and made them go borrow at private banks and start taxing us to pay them interest. So, 40 years later, we've all paid over $2 trillion in debt service at $25 to $60 billion a year. That's $70,000 apiece would be in each of our accounts if Pierre Trudeau hadn't shut down the interest-free loans. So, yes, I'm a real proponent for legal marijuana, but my prime political reason for getting involved was interest-free loans at the central bank. That's
there
my mission in life.
Wow.
So, that's why I don't mind losing 92 elections.
That's a fun rule. That really
is. Okay, John, we're at the end of the program here. Have you got a shout-out, a person, place, thing, website you want to remind people to go to, on and so forth?
Well, for the marijuana, johnturmel.com/kits. And for everything else, politics, check out smartestmanonearth.ca. Believe
smartest
it or not, nobody else ever took out that site before me.
Really,
And I got a degree in systems engineering and the mathematics of gambling, just like Mr. Spock, right?
Yeah.
Wasn't Mr. Spock the science officer who figured out the odds? So when a guy who's got the same education as Mr. Spock claims smartestmanonearth.ca, maybe I'm right. I sure hope so.
Check
it out.
Awesome.
All right. Alicia, have you got a shout-out you want to throw at anybody?
I would just like to say thank you to John for coming on the radio show and providing us with some great legal background on medical cannabis. That's awesome. That's very informative. So thank you for that. And I would just like to throw a thank you to you, Al, for being such a great host.
Oh, hey, well, thank you. I was expecting that.
And thanks for me, too.
Oh, hey, you're welcome. It's always great to have advocates from across the country come on to the radio show and talk to us about their story or different situations. And you know, that's what it's all about. So we all can learn off of each other. So.
And watch my blog for what happens with Caroline Sturm's Double Jeopardy in Saint-Jérôme tomorrow.
Tomorrow, right? Yes, that'll be very interesting to see how you make out. That's for sure.
Yeah.
Well, good luck on that, eh?
Okay, thanks.
Okay, I will be back next week with my joint host, Kim Cooper. You can find the Pace Radio Show on Facebook. We're on Twitter at Pace Radio. We're on Instagram as Pace Radio Show, and we're online as pace-online.ca. Thank yous go to our sponsors, as always, the friendly folks at BMA Hydroponics, CC Nexus, one of Canada's largest cannabis seed wholesalers, and they're found at ccnexus.global, and also to Canada's for providing us an education location here in downtown Camelford. Also to L Rap of Lifestyle Radio, the man behind the baggie, and to you, John, thank you for coming on the program. I really appreciate you taking some
My
time
pleasure.
To do so.
Thanks a lot.
And to you, Alicia, as always, thank you for everything you do.
Thanks.
And to our listeners, I always got to thank our listeners. We appreciate you listening to the program.
Sure.
That's right. And good night. Talk to you all next week.
Okay. Cheers.
And good night. Talk to you all next week.
So what are you doing?
Nothing.
Why not?
I'm trying to get on this Lifestyle Radio website.
Sounds like a cool website.
Yeah, it's alright. Oh, yeah, I might have it.
You might.